Everyone, thank you very much for joining us today on our webinar. My name is Vera. I'm the marketing coordinator at Delmic, and I'm here today with Sangeeta, who is our application specialist. And today she is going to talk about how to study giant viruses with correlative light and electron microscopy. Just before I give the word to Sangeeta, I would like to mention that you can ask your questions during the webinar, and Sangeeta is going to answer them at the end. So you can see the tab on the right of your screen. This is where you can write all your questions. Also, you can see that we have some questions for you in the polls section. So it would be really nice if you could answer those, because we would really like to know about your experience and also your feeling about this webinar, so we can improve in the future. I think we can just begin. I'm going to give the word to Sangeeta now.
Thank you. So welcome to this webinar on imaging giant viruses under correlative light and electron microscopy. As Vera mentioned, my name is Sangeeta. I'm the application specialist at Delmic, and I work with both the correlative light and electron microscopy as well as the cathodoluminescent solutions. So first, let me tell you a little bit about us. We are Delmic. Delmic was founded in 2010. It's a spin-off company of the Technical University of Delft and the Amolf Institute in Amsterdam. And it was founded by two professors, Peter Kraut and Albert Bollmann. And what we make are integrated products for cathodoluminescence and correlative microscopy. So first off, what is correlative microscopy? It's a combination of two techniques, the first of which is fluorescence microscopy. So fluorescence is essentially a phenomenon where a molecule in its ground state absorbs light, is excited to a higher energy state, from where it decays to an intermediate state, and then the difference in energy is emitted as fluorescence, a fluorescent light. So how is fluorescence microscopy performed? When you have something of biological interest, like a cell, for example, it's possible to label different components of the cell using different fluorescent molecules or fluorophores. And then by having fluorescence emitted from these molecules and imaging that light, you are essentially imaging different components and different functionalities of the cell itself. So what fluorescence microscopy offers is specific labeling and functional information, therefore. And the resolution is of the order of 200 nanometers. So that's important to keep in mind, that the resolution is limited by diffraction of light. So it's of the order of a few hundred nanometers, typically. The other technique is electron microscopy. And this is performed by having a sample shown here, exposed to electrons in a scanning electron microscope or a transmission electron microscope, where the primary electron beam impinges on the sample. And since it's high energy, it penetrates to a certain depth within the sample. So this is essentially a scattering event where the primary electrons interact with the material, leading to a whole host of scattering processes. So you can have secondary electrons, low energy secondary electrons generated, or high energy backscattered electrons generated, also Auger electrons, X-rays, and all sorts of events from within this interaction volume, the size of which depends on the energy of the incoming electron beam. If the sample is very thin, if the sample is thin enough, then the high energy electron beam can be transmitted through, and you can have a transmission image, like in a TEM. What is nice about electron microscopy is that it's performed by labeling the sample with heavy metals. So it's a non-specific staining, which results in you being able to see structural information of the sample. Like you can see in this image here, all kinds of ultrastructure in a cell is visible because of this heavy metal labeling. And the nicest thing is, of course, the high resolution. In a scanning electron microscope, it can be of the order of a few nanometers, and it can be even better in a transmission electron microscope. So correlative microscopy is the combination of these two techniques. So it's combined fluorescence and electron microscopy. A very nice high-resolution correlative image looks something like this. So this is an application from cell biology where you can see a HeLa cell expressing GFP, showing the localization of the lipid diacylglycerol inside the cellular membrane of the HeLa cell. So for more details on this, you can look up this publication. And this high-resolution image was acquired in an SEM using a backscatter electron detector. And the optical image was acquired simultaneously using a 100x oil immersion objective lens. And I'll describe in more detail how such an image is acquired in the following slides. So CLEM, or correlative light and electron microscopy, is very popular in biology, and that's for a number of reasons. So using CLEM, you can have both functional and structural information. And this is very nice because when you have labeling with fluorophores alone, so when you're doing only optical microscopy, you are using specific tags. So you already need to know what you are interested in imaging and find out a way to tag that and then image that. What is nice about having simultaneous correlative electron imaging is that you can also have structural information where you see whatever is present. So you don't need to know in advance what you expect or what you plan to see. So the unknown ultrastructure of a cell can be imaged. And you can have, in CLEM, you can have long-range multicolor labeling. So you can tag different components of the cell and essentially different functionalities using different fluorophores. And you can image them with different colors. And it's possible to identify cells in an unbiased manner because you have both functional as well as structural information to guide you, and not only a grayscale image showing structure. And you can have some nice functionalities like liquid cell imaging, where you can image what's happening in the natural environment. So what is the CCOM? It's an integrated light and electron microscope where you can perform simultaneous correlative imaging. So this system is a system for integrated CLEM, or iClEM. And this is what the CCOM looks like. It's the blue door that you see mounted on any standard SEM. Inside the CCOM, you have the sample, which is mounted in the vacuum chamber of the scanning electron microscope. There is a light source from which the light is guided by means of a dichroic and emission filters, a mirror, and the excitation light from this source is sent to the sample. It excites fluorescence in the sample, and the fluorescent light is collected back and is collected on the camera. This is for the fluorescence imaging. The electron imaging is performed in the SEM in the standard manner, where the electron beam is guided down from the source using the lenses in the column. It strikes the sample, it generates secondary and backscattered electrons, which are then detected using the corresponding secondary and backscattered electron detectors. So this entire system is called the iClEM system and is called the CCOM. So what are the main features of the CCOM? How does imaging on the CCOM work? This is a typical user operating the CCOM system mounted on in this case, a Thermo Fisher SEM. The main features are that the CLEM workflow is streamlined, so there's no sample transfer required between an optical microscope and the electron microscope. They take place inside this system. That's why it's called an integrated workflow. You can use high NA fluorescence, and I'll explain this feature in detail later. The overlay procedure, which is the most challenging part of correlative imaging, the overlay between the optical and the electron images, is performed in an automated manner. And the CCOM is retrofitted onto standard SEMs. And an additional important thing to know is that the software for operating the CCOM is open source. It's both for data visualization as well as some analysis. So here's what the CCOM looks like in detail on the inside. This is the sample, which is on a cover glass. This is a special cover glass, which is glass coated with a thin layer of conducting indium tin oxide. And this is because the sample has to be imaged in fluorescence as well as in electron contrast. So for fluorescence imaging, the sample needs to be optically transparent. So the combination of glass and ITO offers that. And the ITO is needed because for electron imaging, the sample needs to be conducting. So this sample, transparent sample, is mounted on this carrier ring, the metallic carrier ring that you see here. And this in turn is mounted on the sample stage. This is the sample stage, which can move in X and Y in two directions. And you can see through this is the final objective lens, which you can change. It can be a 20X or a 40X or a 100X. And that objective lens is mounted on the objective stage, which has a range of movement in X, Y, as well as Z for focusing. The objective lens is, the system is compatible with immersion oil objectives. So you can use air, water, or oil immersion objective lenses. And this enables high NA imaging, which is a very useful functionality for a high resolution work. And as I mentioned before, the CCOM is a retrofit compatible with Thermo Fisher, Zeiss, Descan, Hitachi, and JOL SEMs. So one of the most challenging parts in correlative imaging is, as I mentioned, the overlay between the two images, the optical and the EM image. On the CCOM, we have an automated overlay procedure. And this is based on the phenomenon of cathodoluminescence, that is the light generated by the electron beam when it strikes the sample. We use this to create a sort of temporary fiducial marker, which is used for performing the alignment. So this is how it works. The light is made to impinge on a grid of 4x4 points. The electron beam, sorry, is made to impinge on a grid of 4x4 points. And the light that is collected from each of these pixels forms this cathodoluminescence image. And since this is the light generated by the electrons, it can be used to align the light image and the electron image. And instead of using a single point, a grid of 4x4 points is used for increased accuracy. So the main benefit of doing the overlay in this way is that the correlation is independent of sample. This method is used on every sample and on different regions of the sample as you like. It's fully automatic and it's highly precise. And what it can correct for is rotation, position, scaling, as well as nonlinear scaling. So that's how the automated overlay procedure works essentially. And you can see here in the schematic that the electron beam from the pole piece strikes the cover glass. So it's not necessarily on the region of interest, but you can choose to do the alignment anywhere beside it. And the cathodoluminescence is collected in the same way that the fluorescence from the microscope is collected, via the objective, the optics, and the camera. So this is how the workflow looks schematically. The first step is fluorescence microscopy. So you have the fluorescence generated by the sample giving rise to an image which looks something like this, for example. The next step is the electron microscopy, which is important to note is performed simultaneously, that is in the same system, without moving the sample, without changing it in any way, or adding contrast or any new sample prep. So the identical same sample is imaged next using the EM. And you get a high resolution image showing the structure, which looks something like this. After this, the alignment procedure is performed using cathodoluminescence, and you can see the grid that is patterned here. So this is the schematic workflow on the CCOM for integrated CLEM. That brings me to the main application of today, which is why we want to use the CCOM for imaging in the field of virology. So you can see on the top left is an SEM image of a kind of giant virus called the Tupan virus. So the discovery of giant viruses, or GVs as they're called, has drastically altered the field of virology because of their extended size and genome compared to what was previously thought to be possible for viruses. So this is these are Tupan viruses, and the scale bar in the SEM image shows that they can be more than 1 micron large. In fact, the TEM image below shows that the Tupan virus is about 1.2 microns, and it's one of the longest known viral particles. So you can see the ultrastructure here. There's a head or a capsid and a long tail with fibrils all over. And such beautiful ultrastructure can be studied like here in a TEM, a high resolution TEM. And these are also the popular techniques for imaging Tupan virus, for example, ultramicrotomy followed by sectioning, and then TEM or STEM, AFM, SEM, and cryo-electron microscopy in general, because it allows the preservation of ultrastructure. So what you see here is that giant viruses, like the Tupan virus, they have a size that's larger than the optical resolution limit, which means that they can be imaged in a light microscope. However, the resolution of optical microscopy is not enough to study the ultrastructure. And that's why electron microscopy studies are popular, even for giant viruses, in spite of them being so large. So what the CCOM offers is a combination of these two functionalities. Giant viruses can be imaged with light and electrons in one integrated system. So for more details about these images, you can refer to this publication, which came out recently. So let's get right into it. The sample that we imaged on the CCOM is described briefly here. And for more details, I will refer you to this publication of 2018. So the Acanthamoeba castellani in PAS medium were infected with the Tupan virus. They were stained with FM464FX dye for the fluorescence imaging. The embedding was in LR white resin in this case. And then using an ultramicrotome, 100 nanometer thin sections were collected on the special ITO glass cover slip that I described earlier. It's important to keep in mind here that the TEM images that I showed here were taken with a sample that was prepared especially for TEM imaging. So it had a high EM contrast agent added, so heavy metal stains. Since we want to do a combination of simultaneous light and electron imaging, the samples that we used for imaging did not contain any EM contrast agent. So they're called uncontrasted. And the imaging workflow, especially for these samples, was that the cover slips, the ITO glass cover slips with the sections, the 100 nanometer thin sections, were mounted in the CCOM. So first, we located the cells in the CCOM using fluorescence with the dye. And we used a 40x objective lens and excited the dye with 467 nanometer LED. Then, after locating them, we set it up for the final imaging. So the objective lens was changed to a 60x water immersion lens. The system was closed and pumped down to the standard SEM vacuum of the order of 10 to the power minus 6 millibar. Then we located a region on the sample which was not of interest, and we went there to optimize the beam imaging parameters. So the electron beam energy, the current, the contrast and brightness of the detector. This was all performed on some region which had some features, but which were not of interest for the final imaging. You can typically always find some dust or scratches or something on a sample that can be used for this. Next, we went to the region of interest, so where the amoeba cells were, and imaged them in fluorescence using a 60x objective lens. Then at the same location, we performed electron imaging using, in this case, the secondary electron detector, which is located in lens. And we used 1 keV beam energy and 100 picoamps current, which was optimized, as I mentioned, at a different location. The imaging was performed in ultra-high resolution mode, in this case in a Thermo Fisher Vireos 460 SEM. At the end of this, the automated alignment procedure was performed, and this generated the overlaid correlative images that I will show you now. So these are the results of integrated CLEM imaging of the Tupan virus on the CECOM. So this is an image which is, you can see from the slider here below, it indicates the mixing ratio of the fluorescence contrast and the electron contrast. So this is 100% fluorescence image. And this is with some additional EM contrast where you can start to see higher resolution features becoming visible. And using the open source software, you can generate any such mixing ratio of optical and electron contrast. And let me go through it. And that takes you from the fluorescence image, where you see not very high resolution features, but a lot of functional information indicating where the viruses are present. And you can go through to the electron image. So you can see these are the amoeba cells, and inside, keep in mind that this is a thin section. So inside what you're seeing is a section of the Tupan virus, for example, that's present here with the capsid and the tail, here, here, and in a lot of locations. These are present, the ones that are present inside the cell, and these are the ones that are present outside. So the main result for identification of single giant virus on the CECOM can be seen very clearly in an image such as this. We can successfully detect single giant viruses on the CECOM using fluorescence, as well as image their ultrastructure in the EM. So while it's true that this is the EM image where you can see the capsid and the tail, so you can identify the gross morphology of the Tupan virus, while it's true that the resolution here is not as high as in a TEM, it is an important result to know that you can image the morphology of the virus in an SEM. And that's done by identifying the capsid and the tail. And it's also important to keep in mind that this can be done using uncontrasted sections. So you can have simultaneous optical and electron imaging without the addition of electron contrast agents. And the convenience of doing it in an integrated system in an SEM is that now you can use this as a tool for screening suspicious samples and virus-infected cells, because it's much faster to image the sample in an SEM than it is to go through the process of the TEM. And you can see a lot of details here, in spite of the resolution being lower than that of a TEM. So with the asterisk here, I've marked the virus factories. The N here represents the nucleus, and you can see the virus particles which are present, and you can also locate which part of the cell they are present in, whether it's the plasma membrane or the cytoplasm, and whether they are leaving the cell or at the edge. So with this, I like to bring your attention to the main conclusion, which is that by developing these kinds of experiments on an integrated CLEM system, the CECOM can be a very useful tool for screening suspicious samples and virus-infected cells, because we're able to identify, image the ultrastructure of single giant viruses. And that brings me to the end of this webinar, and I will be happy to take any questions now. So let me check. There aren't any at the moment. So you can access this webinar online, and if any questions come up, feel free to email. Here is my email ID. You can contact us via the website or email me here at delmic.com. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Sangeeta. It was a really interesting webinar. As Sangeeta said, If you have any questions, please feel free to contact us through our emails, to my email or Sangeeta's email. And you can also find a lot of additional information about correlative microscopy on our website, delmic.com. I also would like to point out that we have quite a dedicated to different techniques, correlative microscopy and also cathodoluminescence. So you're also free to watch those. For example, we have a webinar on super resolution correlative microscopy. I think that might be interesting for some of you. Just feel free to check our website and contact us. And thank you for your attention.